In a paper from 1975, scientists took 245 female Betta Splendens and surgically removed their ovaries. 85 fish died, and 56 regenerated a new ovary to carry on living as female Bettas. But here's where the real interesting part lies. The remaining 104 surviving Bettas took a different path. After 50 to 60 days, they grew longer fins, got brighter colors, and started flaring at other Bettas. They were changing into male Bettas. The scientists then continued by breeding 23 of these neo-male Bettas to normal females, where they acted like normal male Bettas during courtship, and they did actually mate. But they didn't produce as many baby Bettas as normal Bettas. Out of 56 of those spawns, Bettas from only 11 broods made it to adulthood, and most broods consisted of only females. This is actually not the first paper to come up with the idea of spaying female Bettas. The researchers themselves reference several older papers doing the same procedures. One going all the way back to 1937. What really sets this paper apart is the large sample size, which gave their conjectures more believability. Now, it's been over 40 years since this paper was published, and to most people, it may be just a paper. But to a commercial Betta breeder, the power to control Betta genders can actually earn them more money. You see, because male Bettas are more colorful, larger, and generally more attractive to buyers, they sell for higher prices. This leads to a lot of breeders wanting more males in any spawn. Now, despite it successfully turning female Bettas into male Bettas, the method from the 1975 paper is obviously not a solution. It'd be insane for breeders to try to individually perform surgery on hundreds of Bettas, not to mention the mass brutality of the matter. But research continues into other non-invasive ways of Betta sex reversal. In gathering information for this video, I found a slew of papers attempting to masculinize Bettas with pretty surprising ingredients. From honey, to spices, to coconut water, these researchers have tried adding natural ingredients to the water of Betta fry in attempts to get more male Bettas out of the spawn. I've read through about 5 papers, and the results were mostly shockingly high in mortality. Any breeder knows fry from 4 to 14 days are in a critical period. Changing their water condition is very risky. By adding other ingredients into the water and agitating them further, it's not surprising that most would die off eventually. And on top of that, whether or not the treatments actually succeeded is unclear, because without a genetic analysis, we can't tell if the resulting males were originally female or just survivors. Most of these studies are supposed to be based on previous established papers that use multiple hormones to induce sex reversal in Bettas, leading to an overall higher percentage of male Bettas. In one of the earlier papers from 1994, researchers fed Betta fry food containing different kinds of androgen hormones. Androgen hormones are steroid hormones that play a role in the development and maintenance of male characteristics. When they fed the Betta fry with food containing these hormones in high enough dosages, they found that it caused 100% of the resulting fry to be male. That is, if the fry survived. Again, we come to the problem of survival, but hey, at least they succeeded. You see, although using these hormones did net more male Bettas, it raised the mortality rate of the entire spawn. And if the dose was too high, it wiped out all the fry. Not to mention, in another study, they showed that for some synthetic hormones, even if the masculinized fry managed to survive, their growth becomes stunted and they grow to much smaller sizes than normal male Bettas. That same study also described how female Bettas prefer normal males over their sex-reversed Bettas. There was another interesting thing going on with some males from these hormone-fed batches. If you'll recall, in the beginning of this video, the 1975 paper showed that when the spayed female Bettas turned male and were bred, most of their broods were exclusively female. Well, some of these male Bettas from the hormone-fed batches, when bred with normal females, also produced all-female broods. And of course, this is no coincidence. These male Bettas were inferred to be sex-reversed, and probably would have turned out to be female Bettas without the hormone intervention. And the reason that their spawn was mostly or entirely female in gender was because these neomales only had female genotypes, because they were originally female. Well, sort of. Now, this is a little confusing, I know. Well, you see, betas don't exactly have a sex determination system like ours. Humans are used to the XY chromosome sex determination system. Although it can be much more complicated, having a Y chromosome generally means the individual develops into a biological male, and two X chromosomes usually means a female. Recently, in two preprint papers, two independent teams of scientists have found a gene in betta fish that somewhat acts like this system. The gene DMRT1 has two versions or alleles. One allele acts like a Y chromosome that only males have, and another is similar to an X chromosome in that both female and male betas have it. But it's not always a clear-cut determiner of gender. As the previous paper showed, functional male betas can sometimes have XX genotypes. And on the other side, although we haven't covered this, there are female betas with XY genotypes. Now, you may be thinking, the functional male betas with XX genotypes we saw were all either surgically or hormone-induced. Perhaps if they were left to nature, then no such cases would occur. But in the same two studies I mentioned, one looking at hundreds of betas, they both found a small but sizable percentage of male betas with XX genotypes and vice versa, female betas with XY genotypes. Note that these betas were collected from either in-house labs or pet shops, thus there was no tampering done to them. So genetics isn't necessarily enough to predict the gender of a beta. And in one of the papers, they state that the presence of males with the XX genotype may suggest environmental factors like temperature could play a role in sex determination in betas. Interestingly enough, a very recent paper from this year came out, and in it, researchers bred three pairs of regular betas, then cultured their fry at lower temperatures than usual, 23 to 25 degrees, for 1 month. Practically all the fry grew up to be female, 159 out of 160. But all this so far has only been about domesticated betta fish, because as it turns out, wild bettas and their relatives probably have more complicated sex determination systems. The determination systems that our pet bettas have is already more simplified, since most bettas with XX genotypes are female, and most with XY genotypes are male. That's already pretty good, and this system is actually the result of our domestication of them. We've been domesticating bettas for at least 1,000 years, and it's not surprising that we've altered their sex determination system. It's thought that betta breeders selectively bred bettas to get more predictable ratios of females and males. So while this entire video we've talked about efforts to completely influence the betta genders, in reality through selective breeding for centuries, we've already been doing that. And that's it for today's video. Thanks for watching, and make sure to leave a comment below telling me what you'd like to see in our next betta video. Don't forget to like and subscribe if you enjoyed the video as well. Bye!